Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out this evening to just be with us tonight. I'm here with my good friend, Tricia Nelson, and we're just going to talk emotional eating. Like, face it, who hasn't had that issue come up? Just about everybody has had that come up. And, you know, whether it becomes a pathology and it like really runs your life and sends you down a path of self-destruction, or whether it's just something that you occasionally tend towards because, you know, it's the way you deal with emotions that you want to stuff. It's still a problem, and it can cause a lot of health issues as well as psychological, emotional, relationship issues, and lots of that. So I was really excited when Tricia decided to write this book because she's an expert in this. She's been through it herself. She's an amazing story. And it was a tough road out of it. She never thought she was even going to get out of it. And she shares that story in her new book. And I've been through it myself. And I know, like a lot of my clients that I deal with, a lot of people who join our programs, they come and they learn all this great stuff about what to do, and they can't follow through because of this demon in their heart and their head and their psyche that takes over, that drives them to eat emotionally. And I, you know, we all get there. I still get there sometimes. I'm tired. It's late. I really want to go for a run and a swim and go have some fun, but I can't. I've got to work, and I reach for, you know, something to eat. Now, these days, what I reach for are not self-destructive foods. They're usually, but still, it's the act of reaching for food, right? It's not what we do. It's that act of it and how we're trying to avoid. So I would love for you to share a little bit about your story. I know you were on a few weeks back and shared a lot of your story, but just connect with people on that, you know, because they really, a lot of people just go into that. Then they go into that whole self-deprecation thing. And I'm just bad. I'm evil. I'm not good. I'll never have a real life. And it's challenging. And I would love to talk about that. And I'd also like to make sure we cover, I get these questions all the time. I'm doing great. And then something happens and I self-sabotage, or something happens and my family members come in. And it's like, they want me to stay in this self-destructive path. So they do things that they know are going to trigger me. I know my mom used to do that with me all the time. She knew my trigger points, and they didn't like it when I got out of that mode that they were used to. So I've said enough, but I just want people to hear from you because you poured out your heart in this book, and I totally love it. And I love that you did it.
Thank you, Ritamarie. I'm so happy to be here. And yes, I've been on a journey. And we all are. Anybody who struggles with food and weight, it has been on a journey. There's no question about it. And, you know, my journey started when I was really young. And I think from as far back as I can remember, I loved to eat, you know, and I had trouble not overeating because I loved food so much. And I always loved the ooey gooey chewy foods, and I was just drawn to them. And I'd stand by my mother's side when she was baking, and I'd lick the little, you know, the mixer things. And anything that was sweet and, you know, sugary and starchy, I just was all over it. So it was a big obsession for me. And I have a propensity to gain weight very easily, very slow metabolism. And I started packing on the pounds at a young age, and I hated being fat. It was so, so miserable for me. And I was, you know, I was heavier than my friends, and I was embarrassed. And, you know, I had low self-esteem because I thought, who would want to hang out with me the way I look? And I didn't look that bad, but in, you know, between my ears,
make ourselves worse than what
I call it fat head. I had fat head in a big way. And then I hit adolescence, and then I just, my weight just, you know, totally skyrocketed. And I was like round, like my face was like a complete ball. Like, it was so round, and it was just awful. And I, you know, I started in high school, I started to do things like taking Dexatrim which is over the counter, you know, speed basically. Yeah. And I was going to gyms and doing all kinds of crazy things, lotions and potions and pills. And I, you know, try to diet, but I just always broke out. Like, any kind of diet I would do, I would give up on very quickly because I had to have food. I just had to have it. And, you know, I got to the point where I just felt like I was hopeless because I tried so many things. I even went to a 12-step program. I went to therapy, like an eating disorders therapist. So it's like, I was not a slouch. Like, I was doing everything I could do, and it still wasn't helping me lose weight and keep it off for any length of time. I just was a real yo-yoer, you know, up 10, down 5, up 20, down 10. I mean, it was just, I had like at least 4 or 5 pairs of pants or sizes in my closet just because I didn't know what size I was going to end up with. So it was really frustrating for me. And because I tried so many things by the age of 21, I felt pretty washed up and like, you know what? I got that nothing was going to work. And I felt very hopeless and helpless. And I met a man who is a spiritual healer who focused on helping people with addictions. And his name's Roy Nelson. And I saw miracles happen in other people's lives who are working with him. Like their bulimia was like eradicated overnight. I mean, people's compulsions to overeat was just like removed. And I just was like, I need help from this man. That's the guy I need to talk to. And I did. And he began to help me. And it really changed everything for me because he took me beyond just the focus and obsession with food and weight to a deeper level, to really addressing the underlying causes. And that's what I needed. That's absolutely what I needed. And that is emotional eating, you know, and that's what happened for me. And it changed everything for me. And I was able to, you know, no longer have to live in a, you know, like 50-pound overweight body and be thin. It's been close to 30 years in a thin body by the grace of God. And I don't have to obsess about food or weigh and measure or do a lot of control things around food. I really, you know, when the underlying stuff is healed, when I know myself, when I deal with the underlying causes, I no longer have that compulsion to overeat. And to me, that's really the only hope. I mean, you can clamp it down by hook or by crook, but eventually, you know, we're going to bust out because that compulsion is bigger than me. So I have to do something about why I have that compulsion, what's driving the compulsion, what the underlying emotions are, and also what kind of lifestyle I'm living that would drive me, you know, what kind of stresses in my life that would cause me to need the excess food as really a stress reliever. So these are the things I was taught by Roy. I joined him in helping others for the past 30 years. That's what we've been doing together. More recently, I'm taking the work we've done together. And I mean, his work is amazing. He works with people in person, but I've taken everything I've learned from him and from our process and from my own journey online through Heal Your Hunger. And I have a program. I wrote the book, you know, the 7 Simple Steps to End Emotional Eating Now, the Heal Your Hunger book. And then I have a program based on that book that really helps people, you know, begin to heal from emotional eating, which to me is the only hope of having permanent weight loss. So that's what I'm doing here. And it's thrilling. It's fun. I love sharing my experience. It's been an amazing ride. And I know what it's like to be completely, you know, just flattened by food. I mean, just absolutely beaten by food and the food compulsion. And I just don't want people to have to live that way anymore.
Right. Absolutely. It's like you don't have control after, you know, you feel like you don't have control over this. It's just controlling you.
Absolutely.
So that book is available on Amazon. And we also have a link. You can get it on her site and get some extra bonuses. So Nicole is going to put that link in there. She's going to tell me what that link is.
Yeah, if somebody buys it through Amazon, actually, and goes back to that link you're going to provide, they'll get a host of bonuses as well as like off the bat, whether they buy the book or not. If they go to that link, they'll actually get 3 free videos on different topics like sabotage and like people pleasing and these different and worry, sabotage and people pleasing are 3 videos they're going to get right up just by going to that link and then signing up.
That's great. So yeah, just put the link in. It's drritamarie.com/go/heal-your-hunger. So drritamarie.com/go/heal-your-hunger. And I see all kinds of hearts and stars and everything coming up. And I know you guys are doing that because you relate, right? You totally can relate to Trisha's story, to Trisha's journey, because it's one that we all, you know, at some point in our life have dealt with. And some might still be dealing with in that really difficult way, right? I see a lot of people I recognize. Michelle, oh my goodness, my niece is on. Lynn and Robert in Georgia and Jeanette and Janine and Jennifer and Richard, Maria. And Janine just shared this. So thank you for sharing. If you know anybody that you think would be really benefited from this, go ahead and share it. There's Maria. And Robert says, I'm here. Janine says, hi. So here's what we want to do. I want to make this about how you can get what you need. I had a couple of things that I wanted to talk to because I hear it all the time when I'm working with folks. Oh my God, there's tons of hearts coming through. So what I'm hearing, keep the hearts coming. It keeps us, you know, really feeling like, like this is worthwhile. But you know, it is. This stuff is just so impacts every core, every cell of your body, but every aspect of your life. And so I want to talk about some of the things I hear, and I would ask Tricia to deal with some questions that I get all the time with people in my programs. But if you've got particular questions, just go ahead and type them in and I'll come back and you know, we'll keep looking at them. And I finally think I figured out how to get this stuff to show up. So yay. Yeah, absolutely. Great. So I can do that. So I want to, before we get any questions coming in, but please do post them because it really makes this interactive and it makes it real. First of all, I highly recommend the book. I mean, there's so many steps and things that you can do that are in that book that you may not have thought about before. You may have thought about, you know, locking all the food into a cabinet so you can't get at it, but that's not quite addressing the problem, right?
No, not at all. In fact, I tried that very early on. It's so funny. I just came across a book from my fifth grade, and it was like a journal that our teacher had us write. And in that journal is a thing about resolutions. And one of my resolutions is stop stuffing my face. Literally in fifth grade, I wrote my resolution, stop stuffing my face with food. I mean, it goes back a long way.
Back a long time. And it was probably back to some pain, right? Can you address that? Because, you know, I know that there's usually it's a pain and the food just takes you away from whatever the pain discomfort is. So
there's no question about it. And I talk about it in the book. See if I can come up with a graph. There are three primary drivers right here. I don't know if you could see, I'm going to put it right up here. There's a graph here and it's, there's three drivers of emotional eating and all addictions. And this is something that we identified many years ago, and it's the three primary drivers. And if you're struggling, it's in there, I promise you. And we call it the PEP formula. Okay. So the P stands for painkiller. So we overeat as a way of killing pain. And so pain is, can be it usually from our childhood. There's no question about it. We have trauma from our childhood. You know, most emotional eaters have had some things in their past, whether it's sexual abuse or physical abuse, or emotional abuse, a death or whatever it is, a lot of, you know, hard things, one or many hard things that we experienced that contribute to our dysregulated eating. And so, our adult lives, what happens is on account of those traumas is we develop a personality traits that I call the anatomy of the emotional eater. It's one of the chapters in this book, The Anatomy of Emotional Eater, which are personality traits that we develop as emotional eaters that are really, there's 24 traits that are really our traits, if you will. They're human qualities, but we have them to the nth degree, and we have this package of 24 of them usually. And these are personality traits that really create stress and anxiety in our lives. And the good news about this is that means we can reverse these things. You know, if the cravings to overeat just struck us at any time without any participation or contribution in our part, we'd be pretty much screwed, right? We'd just be at the, you know, at the mercy of cravings. But what I know from my experience and the experience of helping hundreds of people over the past 30 years is that, no, we actually have these traits, which do stem from our childhood, which actually, you know, ways that we operate in the world that create the stress that we then eat over. So the good news is we can reverse these traits. We can work around them and with them so that they no longer drive us to the kitchen. But back to the painkiller and the PEP formula. So we do eat over pain, you know, and it's pain in our everyday life. But usually there's, you know, if we're hysterical, it's historical. So usually there's there's something in the past that really brought this pain up. And then all we're doing is recreating situations in our lives that are bringing up that same pain until we address it. So we eat as a painkiller to tamp down that pain so that we don't feel any pain. That's why we're so drawn to the sugars and the starches and the fatty foods, because they are heavier, denser foods, and they put a blanket on our emotions. We don't binge on salad because we're still going to feel our feelings if we're eating salad. So we're eating heavier, denser, you know, more sedative foods so that we don't feel those emotions. So it's killing our pain. So that's the P in the PEP formula.
Yeah. And I want to just say before you go on, because I realize that people think, oh, P, why would I have this? I had a great childhood. My parents were great. Nobody abused me. Nobody hit me. Nobody. But there's a lot of little things that happen as kids, little just misunderstandings of situations and taking like responsibility for something that wasn't your fault because you think, you know, your parents fought. I mean, it could be as simple as listening to arguments with your parents, having something that was said that was maybe not the best thing in the world that was said that you took so deeply to heart and hurt so badly from it. So it's not just the realm of people who are emotionally or physically abused or sexually abused, but the emotional abuse. And it could be mild emotional abuse that you can look back as a grown adult with a rational, expanded mind and go, well, why did I take that so seriously? But that wounded child takes it seriously and then acts. So I just wanted to be clear on that.
It's so true. And one of the traits in the anatomy of the emotional eater is to be, we're overly sensitive as emotional eaters. We're extremely sensitive. So things that would roll off of somebody else's back doesn't roll off of ours. Like we file everything away because we're so sensitive and we're so in tune with the energies around us. Very empathic. So, and pain doesn't have to be childhood either. It's like in our daily lives, if we're in a marriage that's troubling to us, or we're in a job we hate, or, you know, we've got an overbearing boss. I mean, it's a jillion things could be happening in our lives that can be like weighing us down, causing this emotional pain that we're then, you know, turning to food every night just to quell, just to quiet down. So that's the first one. The E in the PEP formula is escape. So we use food as a form of escape. Now, emotional eaters are also extremely fearful. We feel, you know, I didn't have a lot of reason to be afraid growing up. I had a good childhood for the most part. And yet I was terrified of so many things. Like we used to do a lot of boating and I was always so afraid that we were going to capsize, or I was so afraid of speaking to people about my feelings. I mean, so many fears that I had, and, you know, living in fear is exhausting. And so eventually we just say, we want to just shut it down for a little while, right? You know, shut the head down, the racing mind, which is also a trait of the emotional eater and part of the anatomy of the emotional eater. So when we have these crazy racing thoughts, you know, we just want to break from it all. We want to escape from it. And that's what food does for us. Again, the heavy serotonin boosting foods like starches and potato chips and anything starchy and sugary, that's going to give us that little relief, you know, just deaden everything and get, you know, get us away from what's going on between our ears. And the third thing, the other P stands for punishment. And we use food as a form of punishment. And a lot of people don't think of this because food is like our greatest reward, right? Like it's like what we want more than anything is to go home, get our favorite binge foods, you know, get our favorite binge TV show now. And we now binge on TV and we sit in front of the TV and we veg out and we eat. And the thing is, it seems like a treat, you know, at first, because that's what we want to do to get away from it all. But if you think about the consequences and what happens when you do that, and the fact is we always overeat when we're in that intentional, like, I want to check out mode, we always eat too much. We always, you know, pile it on or we stuff ourselves. And so we feel sick, you know, we pass out. And the next day we're bloated, we're stuffed. We don't fit into our jeans. We've got a zip pop, like showing up on our face. We cancel, you know, we don't go to the beach with our friends. That's for damn sure. You know, we cancel appointments with friends because we just feel disgusting. So think about that. That's what we do to ourselves time and time again. With every intention to reward ourselves, we end up punishing ourselves. And that's like a built-in mechanism of addiction, is that even though we intend to just get the, you know, a little load off, we end up just beating the hell out of ourselves with our addictions. So when that happens, what's really a form of punishment? Why do we punish ourselves? Well, emotional eaters are very prone to guilt. We're very guilt-ridden. You know, we feel, again, we feel deeply and we feel guilty about everything, you know, just everything. We take everything so hard. We're, you know, ruminating about conversations that happened. I mean, things that we've done 20 years ago. I mean, it's just, again, heavy emotional load. And we're actually beating on ourselves with food. We're using food as a form of punishment. And there's no better form of punishment for people like us, because it hurts like hell. You know, it hurts like hell to gain weight and not fit into our jeans and watch our bodies expand. It's the worst form of punishment there is if you have this problem. So the PEP formula, the pain that we're looking to cover up, the fear that we're looking to escape from, and the guilt that we use, you know, food to punish ourselves with, these are the three primary drivers of emotional eating, even though we're not conscious of it. You know, yeah. At the outset, Ritamarie, in high school, I'm like, I just like food. Like, I'm not an emotional eater. My sister came home one day and declared she was an emotional eater. I'm like, that's the silliest thing I ever heard of. I just like food. Well, after the seed was planted, I began to observe my behavior. I thought, you know, there's something not normal about the way I eat. And it's a lot more than just a love affair with food. And that's really what's going on.
Yeah. So how does somebody know if they're an emotional eater? Because I know we all have this. We all have times, I'm sure, that we go for food, and there's some people who maybe don't. I remember my sister would sit there and we'd be eating ice cream for dessert, and we had a large family, so it'd be a little bowl of ice cream, and she would eat like half of hers and then she'd be done. She'd move it away and I'd finish mine and I said, can I have yours? Yeah, sure. And I'd finish hers. And I remember saying to her, well, how could you, why did you stop? Like, why didn't you finish it? She's not hungry anymore.
Yeah.
And I remember the thought in my head going, but what does hunger have to do with it?
Exactly. Yeah, that's a very crazy notion.
Right? What does hunger have to do with it? That's ice cream. That tastes blissful on your tongue. Like, why don't you turn that away? And so a lot of us, you know, we develop that. That's more of my, you know, susceptibility to that. And you didn't have that.
Right. Yeah, no, it's really important. I have a quiz on my website called the Emotional Eating Quiz that does help people determine. It's a spectrum. You know, my feeling is that everybody's an emotional eater because God made us that way. I mean, we respond to food favorably so that we'll keep eating, you know?
Right. So otherwise we don't dwindle away. Somebody actually came on a call the other day and said, you know, I have a client who her problem is she doesn't get hungry. And sometimes she goes 3 or 4 days and doesn't eat. And how do we stimulate her? Like, wow, that is an unusual problem.
Yeah, so unusual. Yeah. So, but people can take that quiz and really determine where they are in the spectrum, because that's the key. Yeah. Because the higher you up are on the spectrum, the more you teeter into the food addiction territory, which I'm a total food addict. You know, I've totally packed away 5,000 calories in a sitting. I mean, a really violent, crazy, crazy binging. Wow. So, but if somebody takes that quiz, they're going to find out where they are in the spectrum. And there's really four levels, sort of 1 through 4, to really determine where you are on that. And, you know, but it's really sort of a self-diagnosed problem. If you don't like how you eat, if you feel like you do lose control, you're probably an emotional eater, because you're not losing control, you know, for health reasons. You're losing control because of the emotions are driving you.
Right. And very few people sit and eat 5,000 calories worth of broccoli or kale.
Yeah, no, it's total empty, total crap, empty calories, sugar, starch. My three favorite food groups were sugar, starch, and fat. You can bet.
For me, it was a big bowl, like a mixing bowl, like you'd make a cake in, big bowl filled with ice cream and then loaded up with whipped cream and bananas and chocolate chips and then a can of Hershey syrup. And I'd just sit down to the whole bowl.
Yeah.
And I'd feel awful afterwards.
Yeah.
But I thought at the time that awful feeling was better than what I was trying to get away from.
That's the thing, is it's, you know, in the immediate, when we have those cravings, we just feel like I've got to take care of these feelings right now. Yeah. It's, but there's a better way. There's definitely a better way.
And I know that you teach it in your book and in your program, but you know, I was thinking about this. Is there a difference really between emotional eating and alcoholism or drug addiction?
Well, again, if somebody's in the food addiction territory, no difference as far as I can see. I mean, from my experience, I'm an outright food addict, and I also am an alcoholic, and I don't drink anymore on account of it. But I was highly allergic to alcohol, so I would black out when I drank, overdrank. Yeah, like at age 14. So I'm highly allergic to alcohol, and alcohol is the most refined form of sugar there is. And so it goes, bears out why sugar is such a problem for me and why I can't handle sugar, because I'm just as physically addicted. So basically, when you're talking about food addiction, and emotional eating, I mean, if you're a food addict, you're an emotional eater. It goes hand in hand. But if you're an emotional eater, you're not necessarily a food addict. If you have the ability to control at certain times, or you're not too out of control, you sort of pull yourself back. But somebody who can't pull themselves back, they've been fighting the same 20 pounds for, 10 years. They're probably a food addict. And it just means that we're dysregulated in our eating and can't control our food intake, when we're eating certain foods. I mean, the tricky thing about being a food addict is you can't put the plug in the jug and stop eating, And so it's really,
That's so hard.
It's like the hardest addiction to overcome. I mean, really, people have no idea how hard it is. They think, you're powerless over a donut. How stupid is that? but it's for real, because you have to eat. So it's a very tricky thing. And that's why, I'm so passionate about helping people with emotional eating, dealing with the underlying causes. Because when you deal with the underlying causes, then your attachment to food for emotional eating is relieved. It's healed. And so food then becomes nourishment. It can be pleasure as well. I enjoy my meals. I love my meals, but but I don't have the emotional need for the anesthetic of food. Like, I don't need to cover my emotions with food. I can face my emotions through all the different self-care secrets and different things that I share in my book. There's a way for people to really address their emotions, so their emotions aren't being, addressed through their eating. And that's really the key, because that will cut the cord. Like, that'll help people just be neutral with food, have food be, we have to be aware of what we're eating, obviously, and there's certain triggers. And I still don't want to eat sugar because it'll make me crazy,
It'll trigger the whole behavior you feel.
The physical allergy of certain foods and carbs and sugars is real. I mean, that's real for sensitive folks, and most food addicts have that sensitivity. So that's nothing to sneeze at. If you're trying to lose weight, but you're eating foods that you're highly susceptible to that make you crave more, that's, you're never going to get where you need to go. So there's definitely a lot of consciousness around the foods that we eat. And I know you do such a beautiful job of teaching that. So important. But beyond that, the emotional connection, using food for more than just nourishment, for more than just, sustenance and just general pleasure, that's really when you get the addiction phase. And that's really where we have to do that deep emotional work in order to just cut that cord.
Awesome. I think it's awesome. I think, the other thing which I started thinking when you brought that up was that, like you said, susceptible foods. So chocolate, people say to me, well, is chocolate? I said, well, chocolate has some really good benefits. Chocolate has some antioxidants. There's all this stuff. So how do you feel when you eat it? Do you feel like I need more? I can't just have a little bite of it. Do you feel like you just ate, your fill and you're done? Or are you craving and you're wanting more and you're going out to the store to buy more? And that would be a distinction, no? Like, knowing that if I eat broccoli and I'm full, I stop eating broccoli, right? If I eat chocolate and I'm full, I'll keep eating chocolate.
Or
that kind of thing. So therefore, no matter how healthy you make it, with lohan and, herbs in there, if you're addictively going for it and you don't stop at the reasonable amount, then it's a problem. And
you have
to be, curtailed to do this.
No doubt. And so much of the time, because we need it emotionally, we do all this rationalizing in our head, but they said, health advocates, health practitioners can really do a disservice to emotional eaters, not realizing that we take their little bit of advice of, eat a little bit of chocolate each day, and we go to town, or
you have a square every day and you're eating a whole bar or two. Right?
Yeah. Like, I would never be happy with one square of chocolate. Yeah. So it's like,
you don't need any.
we have, Yeah, we have to filter it through the knowledge of ourselves as emotional eaters. And that's why my book is so important, because people, we need to own what we have. You know, it's sort of like diabetes. If you don't realize you have diabetes or admit you have diabetes, you're constantly going to be struggling and hurting your body, you know? Right. And so it's like, we have to know what we are as emotional eaters and what that means. And it's not just, oh, I eat over my emotions. We need to know those 24 character traits, you know, that make up being an emotional eater, so that we can sidestep the traps that we get into just in our living. Put away food just in the way we live. We need to sidestep our tendencies in the way we react to life, so we don't get in trouble with food. So the more we know about ourselves as emotional eaters, the more we begin to negotiate life and begin to really live in a more sane way. Because the bottom line is, we don't want to go through life just fighting that chocolate bar. You know, it's like, even if so-and-so doctor said it's okay to eat it, that doesn't mean it's okay for us to eat it, because we have to filter this through being an emotional eater and the way it owns us. I mean, I can't open a bar of anything and eat a bite of it and put it away. I will know it's there. Like, I know it's there. It lives in my head. Like, wherever it is in my house, I know exactly where it is. So, you know, until I finish it. Like, it's just, that's the way I am. You know, it's just guilty as charged. So I have to know the information. Otherwise, I'm constantly trying to do things, trying to be normal. You know, the obsession with normal is such a conundrum for people like us, because we feel so abnormal. We feel like, what is wrong with me that I can't do what Sally's doing? Like, Sally can just eat a little bit and leave it alone, you know, but I'm not Sally. You know, I'm not Sally. I've never been like Sally. So I need to know that I'm Tricia, and these are the issues I have. And this is, even though you can deal with the emotional stuff, we also have to realize what our tendencies are. So it's sort of a balance between clearing out emotionally, but still being vigilant about our tendencies and our addictive tendencies, so that we aren't really found really in a trap.
Getting stuck. And the thing you talked about earlier, which I think is so important and it's so ignored, is self-care. It's like, address that, because people think it's selfish. You know, I have this family, I have this job, I have all these things to do. I don't have time to take care of me. I've got to take care of everybody else. And that's part of, I think, this emotional eating piece and what gets us into trouble and into self-sabotage.
There's no question about it. One of the, I'd say, of the 24 traits in the anatomy of the emotional eater, the number one trait of all emotional eaters is being a people pleaser.
Oh yeah.
It's a big problem for us. Like, a huge problem, because we don't have the built-in self-esteem. We try to get it from outside of us and all the things that we do for other people. And what does that do? That just gets us tired, exhausted, and totally resentful, because we never get the praise we're looking for, you know, the kudos that we're needing, because it feeds our self-esteem and our ego. When we don't get it to our satisfaction and we're exhausted and we spend all this extra time and money and whatever trying to, you know, create this effect in other people, we're pissed off, we're hungry, we're tired, you know, worn down, we go home, and that's a perfect prescription for a binge, you know, angry, resentful, tired, and, you know, exhausted, basically.
Yep. Yeah. And then you go home and you just take it out. And because who wants to feel that way? Right. And you just think food will dampen it. But, you know, the way I look at it now is like, I look and say, well, okay, if I go with the food, yes, I'm not going to feel it right now, but how am I going to feel later? How am I going to feel in 10 minutes, in 2 hours, in 2 days?
Right. But it's really important that we take a look before we get to that point. And that's really what's so important, is that we, you know, when somebody asks us to do something, how are we, like, we have to play it out. How are we going to feel if we take on that task that isn't ours to take on, that somebody else could take care of? How are we going to feel if we do that extra work when we're already ready to go home at the end of the day at work? You know, how are we going to feel spending another hour at work when we're already tired, need to go home, need to, like, regroup, and basically take that extra time and, you know, exert our bodies and exhaust ourselves? How are we going to feel? We're probably going to feel spent and tired and totally out of juice, in which case we're either getting, you know, replenishment from the vending machine or on our way home from work. So we have to really play it out. And that's where people pleasing is such a trap, because it seems like, oh, sure, I'll do these things for you. I'll expend all this energy, you know, so you'll like me. or just so I can be of service. I mean, it's not always for just so we can be liked, but the bottom line is I can't afford to do things that are going to waste my energy that I'm then going to want food to replenish me with. Like, it's really, we have to really play it out. Like, I have to be a conservator of my own energy.
Yeah.
You know, because I can't afford to get spent because food will be staring me at the face, you know, and I have to meditate every day. I have to say no to certain things. If I don't take on, you know, I don't take on projects that run into my dinner time because I don't want to wait 2 more hours to eat dinner because I'll be starving and I won't make the right choices. It's like, we have to really be cognizant of the way we're living our lives. And this is what's missing, I think, in the weight loss story and all the, solutions out there is people aren't taking a look at their lives. They're taking a look at their food, but they're not looking at their lives, you know, and how we live our lives, because how we live our lives is going to determine how we end up eating.
Great, great. So you've shared a lot. There's a lot more to share, and that's why you wrote a whole book about it. So I really appreciate that. I'm looking to see, nobody's really putting, I think we're just mesmerized by what you're saying. I don't see any specific questions popping up, but we had a whole bunch more people joined. John, hi, John. I haven't seen you in a long time. Lydia, Martha, Doris, Lorna, Lee. Oh, wow. There's a whole lot of people. Laura, another Laura. Mike, my family keeps coming to my Facebook.
Aw, that's sweet.
Hi, Mike. Rachel, wow, I haven't talked to you in forever. Susan, John, Michael, Suzanne, Catherine, Maureen, Venus. Oh, Venus, I haven't seen you in a while either. Bob, and then Rob. Hey, Rob. So I'm so glad you guys are here. And I'd love it if you can relate, you know, maybe you don't relate, but you know somebody who relates, right? Share this link and have the person look at the book or get the book yourself. And send us some hearts, you know,
And the book, I just FYI, is only $6 on Amazon. It's crazy. It's crazy. Oh, I don't make any money on the book. I think I give Amazon $5 and I get $1. So I made it cheap because I want people to have this book and you can send it to somebody as a gift through Amazon. It's so important. But when you buy it on Amazon, get your little code, your purchase code, and then put it in this link and you'll get all kinds of amazing, really amazing bonuses.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's drritamarie.com/go/heal-your-hunger. The link you gave me was long and convoluted.
Yeah. Ugly.
This one, I just changed it so you can go. Yeah. drritamarie.com/go/heal-your-hunger. So $6 on Amazon. You can't go wrong. This is, books are just, they're just such treasures. You can see, I love them. I'm surrounded by them and I have the book and I've read it. I had a really good time reading it and just relating to it and helping it to relate to some of my clients. Because the biggest thing I hear all the time is the whole thing about the self-sabotage, you know, or the people pleasing is what you just said. I always talk about social eating and emotional eating, but the social, the pressure of, oh, come on, just have one. Don't insult me. I made all these candies for you. And
I tell you, if Jesus were serving me a meal, I'd think twice about saying yes if it wasn't what I wanted, you know, didn't work for me.
Exactly.
Sorry, Jesus, it looks good. You know, just bless me and I'll eat my own food.
I'll eat my own food, right? That's awesome. That's awesome. So it doesn't look like there's questions. I think you did a great job of answering them. If you don't mind coming back later, sometimes people post questions and I usually come back later and answer the questions or the comments. You know, Tricia will come back. So if you have any questions, I just say go get her book because it's just, you know, it's a $6 investment and then you'll get her videos on top of it. And really, if this is something that you think someone else could benefit from, somebody else in your life that you love, if you're a practitioner, share this with your clients. You know, if you're a mom and you're watching your kids struggle, or a kid and you're watching your mom struggle, or you're struggling, then share this with them. Send them the link to this, or just hit share right here on Facebook. And let's go. So let's give Tricia some more hearts. I really appreciate all that. And let her know that we love her and we care. And I really appreciate you taking this on because, like I said, it was a problem for me from, you know, the time I was a little one. And I dealt with it until I learned more. But I mean, I'm still learning. There's more and more emotional pieces. You know, I did it with pure, like, I'm not eating this anymore. I'm going to pretend I'm an alcoholic and, you know, I'm not drinking anymore. I'm not eating sugar anymore. I'm going to be rigorous about it. And it works for me. But I also realized over the years that I have to get charge of the emotions, because I remember switching my diet around and no more processed food and no more sugar. But I would sit there and eat dates with almond butter. And I just found 15 date pits around. What are you doing?
Yep.
This is healthy food. This is good.
That's another one of those cons we lay on ourselves, right? Yeah. It's all from Whole Foods. It must be fine to eat.
Yeah. So it's not the what you're eating. The what you're eating is super important. And that's an easy first step actually to change. I think what is the easiest first step. Yeah. And then really working on the emotions is something that's going to give you that long-term freedom. So
yeah,
I so appreciate you and what you're doing. And
thank you, sweetie. Thanks so much.
So many people.
Always good to be with you. Thank you for having me.
Yes, much love. Thank you all for being out here. And yeah, please do share, comment. We'll come back later if you think of another question. But go get the book, because it's going to answer a lot of things for you and give you practical steps for healing your hunger and getting over this emotional eating. Bye-bye. Many blessings.
Thank you.